So good evening, everyone, and welcome to Discovering Buddhism. That's a welcome to both our students and our guests tonight who are here to receive a teaching from Venerable Robina. Since our topic in DB right now is the wisdom of emptiness, this ought to be a great evening. I have a couple of announcements for our Discovering Buddhism students real quickly, and then Donna will have a few words. Next week at Discovering Buddhism is our last class and practice night for this module, so we'll start at 6:30 and go until 9:30. And if you're going for the Discovering Buddhism completion certificate, don't forget to bring your completion card so Steep can sign it for you. And Steep, tonight we're going to be doing a mandala offering to request teachings from Venerable Robina. And Steep wanted us to say something about the mandala offering for those of you who may not be familiar with it, and for those of you who are. And so I got on to the best resource, Alex Berzin's website, which is berzinarchives.com. And thank goodness he had a short explanation of the mandala offering of a request for a teacher. So I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I'm going to read some parts to you. And it's about preparing our minds for this teaching. Before we receive a teaching, it's important to request it with a mandala offering. And when we do so, it's important to understand the significance of the verse we recite with this offering. And the verse is, by directing an offering to the Buddha fields, this base, anointed with fragrant waters, strewn with flowers, and decked with Mount Meru, four islands, sun and moon, may all those who wander be led to the pure lands. Om Idam Guru Ratna Mandala Kam Niryata Yami. I send forth this mandala to you, precious gurus. This verse, in which we're thinking in terms of a Buddha field, a pure land, and praying that everybody be able to share in it, is a little bit difficult to understand. First, we need to understand what a Buddha field or pure land is. It is a place where everything is conducive for being able to study and practice the Dharma 24 hours a day. You don't have to work, you don't have to eat, you don't have to sleep, you don't have to do anything except study and practice all the time. So a Pure Land Buddha field is actually not a place, but a state of mind. So when we make the mandala offering, what we want to imagine is that our minds are in the most conducive state, and may everybody be able to share that type of condition to be able to study. It is in this context that we request a teaching, while imagining that everything is perfect, everything is conducive. In fact, we are saying with this verse, I am totally prepared and open to receive the teaching, and may everyone be like that. That's the essence of the mandala offering of request. It is important to take a few minutes beforehand to try to clear everything in our minds and try to imagine being in a Pure Land Buddha field. Then, within that state, make the mandala offering. And remember, it's not that we're wishing to be the only one there in the Buddha field or clear light state of mind, or that we're getting private teachings because we're so important or special, but making the offering with a strong wish that everybody there be there and receive the teaching. So Donna is leaving right now. One last thing, if we have any questions or comments from the audience and you're handed a microphone, it's because we're streaming and audio recording this session tonight. So please use it. It's for the benefit of those at home who aren't here with us tonight. And when you use it, hold it up to your mouth like an ice cream cone. It won't pick you up down here. Okay, thank you.
Or here. Yeah. Or here. Or like this.
Okay, well, welcome. I'm so excited about this. It's going to be a wonderful week with Venerable Robina. She's teaching every night this week, and also teaching a workshop this weekend on how to enjoy death. And there's a book that she'll be working from that's available in our bookstore. I also wanted to let you know that If you're coming to DB, you won't see this on a regular basis, but you'll see it if you come on Wednesdays or Sundays. Traditionally, when the teacher enters the room, we stand, and that's out of respect for the teachings that the teacher holds. And also, if you come when Geshe-la is here, at his request, because he has such great humility, when he prostrates to the altar, we also prostrate with him. That's not traditional. And so tonight, when Venerable Robina comes, we'll wait while she's prostrating, and then when she's seated, we'll begin prostrating. And anybody who is not comfortable with this practice, it's perfectly okay to just remain standing. Okay, never run and then talk. I also wanted to let you know that Venerable Robina will be leading two different retreats. Well, one is a retreat and one is a pilgrimage this summer and fall in Asia. One is a retreat at Borobudur, and I don't remember what country that's in. And that's in June 24 to 28. And then she's leading a pilgrimage to India and Nepal, and I've been on that pilgrimage twice. Quite a few people at Kadampa Center have been on it. It's really an amazing experience. You go to all the Buddhist holy sites. You're traveling with a bunch of other amazing people who, like you, are interested in Buddhism. Some of them are experienced students, and some of them are people who are figuring it out. So if you are able to do that or interested in it, please consider that. There are postcards right outside on a table with a sign-up sheet if you're interested in getting information. Thank you.
Sāshī Pārkī Shūshīng Mētok Tāmrī Rābdīnshī Nīdē Gēnpā Jetsun Lama Dampa Genam Kichur Kukala Kente Chujin Trig Jita Tsampe Duje Tsima Lashyab Gecherki Charpa Waptu So Idam Guru Rata Mandala Kam Niryatayami.
Okay, are we on? Yes. We're not on. We're on? Yes. So what happened just then? I can't see some of you. This always happens. Oh, you seem to have high chairs in front of the low chairs. If you can't, I like to see you, but if you don't mind not seeing me, that's fine. But if you'd like to see me, wriggle your chair around, you know? Or just move. Don't be polite, okay? All right. But it's really nice to see each other. Well, move your chair up or something. The seat's up here, darlings. Come on up. Come on. Look. Please, spare seats. Yeah. Sit right here. All right. Okay? Good. Okay. So what happened just then was they offered the representations of enlightened body, speech, and mind as like a cause for us to achieve it. It's got meaning, you know. So they offered a statue representing the enlightened body, speech, a text, and mind is represented by a stupa. And then a mandala, which is sort of meant to be all the delicious objects of this world, as an offering to the Buddha, as if the Buddha were here himself, as a request for the teachings. That's what happened just then. Okay. So we're going to sing another little prayer, which is expressing two thoughts. The first two lines are for anybody in the room who already kind of identifies with being a Buddhist. And the second two lines are sort of reminding ourselves of our reliance on the Buddha and his teachings. And the second two lines can be for all of us, maybe. It's stating like our purpose for being here, like an altruistic reason, we'd say. They call it a motivation. We're thinking, okay, we're going to listen to these ideas, Buddha's views about how things are, what is real, what is not, what exists, what doesn't, who are we, blah, 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 you know. The mind, Buddha's expertise is the mind. And why are we listening? To take some tools from it, you know. You can be a 1% Buddhist. I like to say that. It's not joking. So it's up to you, because Buddha's not the boss. We are the boss. I like to say that too. It's not a question of believing or disbelieving. It's a question of listening carefully for some practical tools. What for? To develop what the Buddha would say is our amazing potential on the one side, and then on the other side, on the basis of that, because we live in this crazy world together, tools that we can use to help us help others as well. That's the idea. Sangye charang soke chognam la jancho badu dagni kyab suchi dagi chernyen gipe sonam ki drola penchir sangye drupa shog Sangye chodang soke chognam la jang shubba du dagni kyab suchi dagi chonyen gipe sonam ki drola penchir sangye drupa shog Sangye chodang soke chognam la jang shubba du dagni kyab suchi dagi chonyen gipe sonam ki drola penchir sangye drupa shog. So I think we're supposed to talk about emptiness. Is that the plan?
Yes.
Okay. Well, as soon as we hear that word, we get lost, you know? And then because it sounds like spiritual teaching, we then mystify it. So it's like double trouble. But what we've got to really try and understand is what it means practically and what it means experientially and how we apply it as a tool. So there's this whole kind of massive part of Buddhist teachings, Buddhist literature, that deals with this concept, this business of emptiness, right? Are you people studying the Discovering Buddhism module? Is that why you're here? Mm-hmm. Or are you just here because you're interested? Some people?
It's a mix.
Mix, okay, all right. So really, okay. It's sort of the more advanced approach, you know. This is from the more advanced approach. If you study in the Buddhist monastic university system in Tibet, you know, you kind of go gradually, step by step, and at a certain point in your studies, you then deeply involve yourself in this whole area of teachings, whole area of Buddhist philosophy. So you've got to lead up to it, right? So one way, first of all, really crucial to understand in order to get our head around this stuff is to understand this general approach of the Buddha about the mind. And then before we get into that, let's just remind ourselves of who is this Buddha and where does this information come from. So, you know, we can see this is called spiritual. We just sang a prayer. Look, we're a bunch of nuns. It sounds like religion, doesn't it, you know? But what's very interesting, we have to remember this, that the Buddha, who is this person? He was a regular guy who became this person called a Buddha. And the word in Tibetan for the word Buddha, which is Sanskrit, Sangye, the etymology of it's very interesting. The first syllable, sung, implies the utter eradication from our mind, our consciousness, our very being, all ego and fears and dramas and rubbish and depression and anxiety and low self-esteem and all the stuff that we just assume in our modern views of the mind are totally normal states of mind. For the Buddha and this person, from his own hard work, has discovered directly and experientially that this stuff can be got rid of. This is really the essential point the Buddha's making, which is such a radical concept. There's nothing remotely like it in all of our models of the mind in our culture. So as soon as we hear it, we kind of mystify it, you know, because we think that just sounds like religion. Well, Buddha's a psychologist, and I'm really not kidding there. He deals with the mind. That is his expertise. Then the second syllable, gye, implies the development literally to perfection of all the goodness within us, love, compassion, wisdom, blah, 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 this stuff, you know. These words that we all know are so normal. So the Buddha was this person, and it was His Holiness recently I read, and I like to say this one, I like to quote it. He came out of this amazing tradition, you know, the Indians. It was the Indians, more than 3,000 years ago, who were the ones who came up with this extraordinary investigation into the nature of self. But in our culture, we know about the Greeks and the Romans, right? You know, we're Jewish and Christian. We go back in Europe. We don't know anything about the Indians. They're just these weird people. Unless you're Indian, of course. And even, you know, but these amazing Hindus more than 3,000 years ago, you can't believe the astonishing thinkers that they were. But it's utterly hidden to us in our culture. It's really fascinating. I mean, these extraordinary beings, and they were the ones who cultivated this technique of meditation that's known broadly these days as mindfulness, which actually is this astonishingly sophisticated psychological skill that enables a person to access much more subtle, the subtlest levels of our own conscious being. And this just sounds mystical to us, you know? And it was the Hindus who investigated and came to the recognition of, the discovery of, the experience of these subtler levels of one's own mind. This is a remarkable technique. And then Buddha came out of this extraordinary tradition, right? And they were the ones, the Hindus, the Indians, who then came up with
as a result of exploring their own mind at these deeper levels, certain very clear views about exactly what is the self, who are we, what is a person, what is the self, what is the I, and they came to certain conclusions. Remarkable beings. Well, the Buddha was trained in that tradition. It was an astonishing tradition. So then he came out of that one and went all the way through it, and then he, according to his view, kind of went beyond that view, and he kind of diverged in his own direction. And the key, the crucial piece, is in his own findings about exactly what the self is and isn't, which is the exact topic of this emptiness business. Exactly who we are, what are we, and what defines us. And this is, it's massive in the Buddhist literature, okay? So the Buddha came out of that tradition, and he continued to move using this technique of meditation, this single-pointed technique, as well as all working with all the philosophy, and came to his own experiential findings about exactly what we are and what we're not. Which means, really, that they, and what they're dealing with is not some mystical thing like a soul or a spirit. Buddha doesn't use such concepts. He doesn't talk like that. He talks about the mind and consciousness. These are, broadly speaking, you can say they're used synonymously. So to really begin to even get our head around Buddhism, we've got to take on board Buddha's view of the mind, because again, it's radically different from the way we think in the West. So we've got to get used to this, because it's so different. And of course, we can't prove it immediately what he's saying, so what do? We take these views as our working hypothesis. That's the most intelligent way to do it. And the other crucial thing about the Buddha is he is not a creator. He doesn't assert a creator. Which is pretty shocking, because I think we have a default assumption that religion or spiritual equals creator. No such thing for the Buddha. He says we don't need creating. It's an unnecessary embellishment. And all his own views about this, the view of karma and the view about the mind, the view of emptiness, all of these are the components of his own findings. So basically Buddhism is Buddha's own direct experiential findings. It's not revelation. It's not coming from on high. It's not something that someone else has created. There's no such concept in Buddhism as God's law, as we would talk. We talk about God's law and then natural laws. Buddha's into natural laws. But his view of natural laws is very different from ours, I tell you. So the first thing we have to understand, to even begin to get our head around this topic we're going to discuss tonight, just to remind us, we have to understand what Buddha means by the mind. Well, first, for him, it's used, broadly speaking, synonymously with the word consciousness. Second, it is not physical. Not one atom of it is physical. You ask a great Tibetan meditator up in the mountains who's heard nothing about the materialist views about the world where his brain is, he would not have a clue. He's never heard of such a thing. But he knows his mind, I promise. Consciousness, thoughts, feelings, emotions, unconscious, subconscious. It's this entire spectrum of our inner being. The word mind in Buddhism is used in a much more kind of tasty, subjective, experiential way, you know? It's referring to the actual cognitive process itself. Buddha wouldn't argue there's a brain, but that's not the discussion. The discussion is the actual cognitive process of what goes on in this amazing mind of ours. But to levels of subtlety that we don't even posit as existing in our culture. So it's a very, very different view. The next point about the mind that's, again, radically different for our views is that it's not given to us by anybody else. We are not the handiwork of anybody else, as far as the Buddha is concerned. Neither a creator nor mummy and daddy. You know, if you're a materialist, mummy and daddy created you. If you're a Christian, God created you. Neither of those views Buddha has. He says we don't need creating by somebody else. Yes, mummy and daddy give us a body. Definitely they gave us a body. No argument. So this takes time, because we're so used to thinking the brain, all this business, you know. And then we hear Buddha's view that there's not the mind. We get a bit confused. It takes time, but we can put it all together. We just have to take time, that's all. So we're not a product of our parents. And this is a massive view for the Buddhist view. Massive view. A massive one to take on board, you know. So we're not a product of parents. When our mind is not a product of God, then where does it come from? Pretty obvious question. Well, it comes from previous moments of itself. Think of your mind like a river of mental moments that isn't physical, that goes back and back, well before conception, before, and will continue after we die. So that's the one broad point. Oh, the final point about the mind, which we implied before, is its potential. And again, this is the point of all the Buddhist methodology. To get rid of all the rubbish and grow all the goodness, putting it really simply. This is Buddha's own direct experience. Therefore, it's not a belief. You know, we use belief because it's God's law, and it's not our job to know God's law. Keep your nose out of God's law. That's his business. And your job is, if you're a Christian or a Muslim, to have faith in God. That's perfect. I'm not complaining. But that is not the view here. That's why it's not literally not a belief system. Literally. It can't be. Because Buddha is a guy who came to his own experiential findings about things. So you don't merely believe, like it's like saying you believe in mathematics. You can if you like, but that would be rather foolish, wouldn't it? When you get asked, someone asks you to pass three oranges, you don't know how to do it. So believing it, it's okay, but it's not enough. Believing isn't the point, in fact. It's to experience the truth of it. That's our job. Of course, one step at a time, you know. And so in that sense, it's crucially different. And in fact, if there's something the Buddha has said that you can't prove finally, all the way to perfection, then it's not true. You must reject the Buddha. That's the attitude, you know. That's why it's so important to say the words, to take it as your hypothesis. I never say I believe in Buddhism, purposely, because we're intellectually lazy and we like to believe in things. And we kind of go around like supermarket shopping. Oh, I like that, but I believe in this. No, I believe in reincarnation, but I believe in that one. It's kind of lazy, you know. Isn't it? Well, I'm glad to make you laugh. Is it a bit warm in here? Are you a bit toasty? Can we get some more air, please? I'm just getting excited and I'm getting hot. Okay. So, okay. That's the mind. Just in general, that's the point. So now the crucial point, so we can get to emptiness. The crucial point is this. What Buddha's saying is, the job of this mind, finally, is to cognize that which exists. That's its job. There's a whole mass of stuff in the Buddhist literature about the mind. They go to incredible depth about the mind and how it functions. You know, the concept, all the epistemological model of the mind, the psychological model of the mind. It's extraordinary in depth in the literature, and it's fascinating, you know, fascinating. But the job of mind, as far as Buddha is concerned, is to cognize that which exists. That's that Buddha word. Rid of all the rubbish and full of all the goodness. So you'd have then the quality that you'd be in sync with reality. This is a crucial point for the Buddha, to cognize that which exists. And so the point is this. The rubbish, you know, in the Buddhist model of the mind, very simply speaking, there's a whole bunch of the stuff that's kind of neurotic, delusional, the negative states, this one category. There's another category called the positive, virtuous, useful states of mind. And these are, you know, there's a third category too, but we won't go into those right now. But we need to, yeah. The third one, they're called neutral. And that doesn't mean because they're not important. It's because I like to call them the mechanics of our mind. They're the ability to concentrate, to remember things, like the technical parts. And whether you're a rat or a murderer or a good person, you all need this lot. You know, thieves need mindfulness, as Lama Zopa puts it, because it's the ability to remember what you're doing. So they're neither virtuous nor non-virtuous in their character. And there's lots of these states of mind. We all need to develop these hugely to do this job that the Buddha is saying we need to do and that we can do, in which he said he did, which is to rid the mind of all the rubbish and to grow to perfection all the goodness. Now, why would we want to do that? Because he says, very simply, all the neuroses, all the ego stuff, the fears, the dramas, the attachment, the anger, the pride, the jealousy, stuff that we totally take for granted, that we assume are normal, but which we know are heartbreaking. He says, guess what, folks? They're the cause of suffering. Not just now, but when you look at his view about karma, which is this massive view in Buddhist philosophy about why things happen and how things happen, we create our own suffering and we create our own happiness. And the source of this is what goes on in our mind. For him, the mind is the central player. And what goes on in the mind is the cause of all happiness and the cause of all suffering. So it's a very different view from how we think in our world. Okay? So basically what he's saying is this. All the neuroses, all these, there's like a hierarchy of them, I like to say, you know. And they've got these two key functions. Well, they're actually multifaceted in their function. But the neurotic states of our mind, they have two key functions. One is they're extremely disturbing. One of the terms for them, in fact, is disturbing emotion. Well, like I like to say, check the last time you're angry or depressed or jealous. You don't say, you know, wow, I was jealous yesterday and it was just great. We absolutely know it is beyond bearing, beyond heartbreaking. We know that. But our problem is, we know we're jealous, but we don't think that's the problem. We think the boyfriend who made me jealous is the problem. We think the object of our mind is the problem. We don't think the anger is the problem. We think it's the mean person who was unkind to me. And that's the problem. Buddha says it's the state of mind, and we've got to get in touch with those. And that's pretty intense. We're obsessed with the things the mind think about, the object, the person, the cake, the event. We're obsessed with the objects of our mind. Buddha's deal is the mind itself, the actual experience itself. And this really takes time, you know. So, he is saying these neuroses in us are deeply disturbing. And honestly, if we're really grown up about it, that should be enough reason for us to never want another moment of anger again in our lives. If you eat one piece of food that makes you vomit, you will never touch it again. Ever, will you? You're sensible. But we get angry. But we keep getting angry, and we keep getting jealous, and we keep getting depressed, and we keep getting low self-esteem, we keep blaming other people, so we never end with it. Because we think, we know we're those things, but we think it's everybody else's fault. But the Buddha's deal is very simple. He says it's your state of mind that's the problem. This just takes time to see. Or even more simple, he says we can change them. He says we don't need to have them, and this is what's outrageous for us. But so the first part is they're disturbing. That should be enough for us. But the other one is the killer. And this is his key point. The function of these neuroses, and this takes time to see, and we've got to, and when we can understand this point, we can begin to understand all the teachings about emptiness. It'll all fall into place for us. And that is, these states of mind are liars. They're fantasies. In other words, the extent to which we're caught up in attachment, anger, pride, jealousy, low self-esteem, you name it, we all know them. The extent to which we're caught up in those is one, the extent to which we're completely broken-hearted, disturbed, and two, the extent to which we are not in touch with how things are. As our mothers told us, they make mountains out of molehills. All these cute cliches we learn, but this is profoundly true for the Buddhist approach to the mind. And once we can get our head around this one, once we can see this function, once we can see that anger is exaggerating the ugliness of that person, once we can see that attachment is exaggerating the deliciousness of that cake, once we can see that component, that function, we are really on track with being Buddhist, understanding exactly his approach. This is his amazing approach. And this is the job of being a Buddhist then, to rid the mind of this rubbish. Why? Because you're up to here with suffering. You're sick of suffering, mate. And you want it, so you change your mind. And as you change your mind, as you lessen these neuroses, we don't even get to the subtle part yet, the emptiness business, we're heading there. As we lessen, as we look into this day-to-day, daily job of being a Buddhist, as Lama Yeshe puts it, being your own therapist, beginning to become familiar with your own neuroses and your good qualities, don't forget those, owning them as yours, really owning them as yours, which takes so much time, and then learning this marvelous skill of concentration meditation, just even a little bit of it, to help us develop the skill to see our own thoughts and feelings and emotions and unconscious and subconscious, to unpack and unravel this highly complex conceptual stories that are raving on in our head all day. These are the states of mind we're trying to get in touch with, because these are the ones, the negative ones, are the ones that are the source of all our pain, you know? And this is a really intense job to do. Dealing with your own thoughts and feelings, recognizing them, and then learning ever more clearly to hear how they are embellishers. They exaggerate. They distort the truth. They make mountains out of molehills. This is their key function, and this is the key reason why they cause us suffering. So we know very well, if you've got a $5 note, but you think it's 50, you're in trouble, right? You just made a mountain out of a molehill. And you go off, and what happens? You got $5, you know what $5, you know, but you think it's 50. You get all excited, all anticipating, and you make a plan, you go out there, you spend it, and you get $5 worth. Guess what you'll feel? Disappointment. That's called suffering. Not because the person was mean and didn't give you $50 worth, it's because you made a mistake in the first place of over-exaggerating the status of that $5 bill. That's what Buddha says all our delusions are doing every second. Attachment is constantly there. Before we even begin to understand emptiness, we've got to understand these other delusions. We have to understand emptiness and attachment and anger, the two key ones that run our lives every second of the day from the second we wake up, you know? This is not how we think in the West at all. Attachment is this multifaceted neurosis. that's a distortion, that distorts, that over-exaggerates the deliciousness of things, that's got the energy of neediness and hankering and craving, that has the energy, the even more fundamental, of deep dissatisfaction, which causes us to hanker after something, which then causes the thing to look more delicious than it really is because you build up this big drama in your head about it. And then it causes you to expect what you believe it is, like the $50, and you expect you're going to get that. And then naturally, because it isn't your fantasy, you can only be disappointed. You will only be disappointed. And we spend our lives like this, up and down like yo-yos. You know, the moment attachment is thwarted, the bubble bursts, the thing that you expected doesn't happen, then you go crashing down to despair. And that's a state of mind of aversion, which manifests as anger or depression. And we run between these two like 1,000 times a day. Join the club. It's called samsara. Buddha calls it that. And we live in these delusions, and we think they're normal. You were a therapist, and I come to you and I say, would you be so kind as to give me methods to get rid of all ego, all attachment, all anger, all fears, all depression, all jealousy, and develop infinite love and infinite compassion all the time for everybody, you'll be seriously worried about me. And you'll give me pills to calm down. But this is precisely what Buddha is saying is possible. This is no more or less than precisely what Buddha is saying is possible, which sounds outrageous to us. But this is Buddha's deal, you know. So, if we like what he's saying, we better get our head around it and unpack it and demystify it, you know. And then learn to see these states of mind in our own mind. Then we're really on a roll. We're really on the case. So like I mentioned, I like to say there's like a hierarchy of these delusions. The key one effectively in day-to-day life that's the main source of our pain, this one called attachment, this cute word called attachment, that's got this, like I said, a primordial energy of dissatisfaction, no matter, you know, a sense of being empty, of never being enough, never having enough, never feeling I'm enough. This is the worst part of it, the deepest one. That gives rise to hankering and craving. That gives rise to exaggerating the deliciousness. That gives rise to manipulating and controlling to get it. That gives rise to expecting it. That gives rise then to possessing it. All of which creates is a distortion of the person, the event, the cake, the thing, whatever. So naturally there's a massive disconnect because there's a massive disconnect between the truth of the thing and how I'm seeing the thing through the filter of attachment, suffering and disappointment come. That attachment, in other words, gives rise to aversion. Aversion, the strong aspect of which is called anger, or the internalized one is called depression and despair. Then the other dramas come after that, the jealousy and all the other rubbish, you know. 57 varieties of nonsense. Now, let's get to the root one. This one is so abstract for us because we don't even posit such a concept in our culture. But they all are the product of the root delusion, the mother of them all in this hierarchy. So this is known in Tibetan as ma-rigpa, unawareness, ignorance. But like all these words, they've got very specific definitions. And this is something we really need to understand, you know. The precision and clarity and depth of analysis that we know we need to employ in what we call science, even just in what we call being a good cook, is the precision and clarity and depth of analysis that Buddha would demand we use to know the mind and this stuff we're discussing here. So that we need to be precise. Each of these terms has a name, a definition. We have to understand what we're talking about. Otherwise, it's a mess, you know. So this ignorance, this root delusion, known colloquially, it's very tasty, as ego grasping. It's got two functions, you know. Ordinary ignorance is simple. You know, if you say to me, what's that? And I'll go, I don't know. Well, you'll tell me it's a cup. And I'll say, thank you very much, and now I've just got wisdom. I now know what it is. Well, we'd get enlightened in a couple of years if our ignorance was that simple. That we really would, because we're very clever, you know. But this ignorance is like double trouble. It's got this extra component, and this is the killer. And this is also the same characteristic of all the other delusions. Not only do we not know, let's say, that that's a cup, that's plain ignorance, but we've made up a fantasy story that's not true about what we think the cup is, and we believe the lie. So not only do we not even know the truth, we've made up a lie about it, and we believe the lie 1,000,000,000%. And the Buddha says all the delusions have this function, but in particular, this one, this ego grasping. So speaking really simply, this ego grasping, its particular job, like all the others, like all the other delusions, is to over-exaggerate, is to embellish. So you could say, you know, there's a brown triangle on the plate. This is already, by the way, very interesting, the distinction between our sensory consciousness and our mental consciousness. They talk about this in great depth again in the Buddhist literature. So the eye consciousness goes and looks at that brown triangle, and instantaneously, we know this, isn't it? Quicker than Google, I love this analogy, it's perfect. Quicker than Google, your mental consciousness is accessed, and that's where the workshop is, as Lama Zopa puts it. That's where all my memories are stored. We're not talking about the brain here, we're talking about your consciousness. The Buddha would say everything we see and hear and taste and touch and smell and think about, not one atom of it goes astray. It all gets stored in our consciousness. This is why we can have memory. And we can have extraordinary memory as far as the Buddha is concerned. We can remember past lives and all these kind of things, because that's the capacity of consciousness. So because we remember everything. Everything's stored away. We don't remember it, but it's stored there, accessible to us. So in a millisecond, the eye consciousness sees brown triangle, because eye consciousness cannot see a delicious chocolate cake. It's not its capability. They're like dumb animals, the senses. The eye consciousness can cognize shape and color only. So then the mental consciousness is triggered where all my memories are, and up comes chocolate cake. Up comes the memory I've enjoyed it before, I've seen it before. Up comes the memory of having had it before. Up comes the memory of finding it delicious before. Up comes the memory of then all of these things come in a millisecond quicker than Google, and then out comes, wow, look at that delicious chocolate cake. So there are many states of mind all functioning to have that experience. So the truth is it's chocolate cake. Conventionally, it's a chocolate cake. That's a conventional truth. Buddha says things exist conventionally. There's toilets and cups and saucers and clocks. There's millions and trillions of individual, precisely identified, different conventional phenomena. And to get to this emptiness business, we're leading there, okay? We need to understand the different conventional phenomena. So what's a cup, mummy? What's that brown triangle, mummy? Well, darling, that's called a chocolate cake. And she'll define it for me. Or what's that? Well, that's called a cup. What is it? She'll give me a definition. The first part of the definition tells you its conventional characteristics. It's this flat bottom container. I'll recognize it from that. But I'm not happy yet. I don't know what its job is. And that's the second part of the definition. And this is crucial. That'll tell me what its function is. Well, sweetheart, it holds my tea. Well, don't just believe her. What we're doing here is what the Buddha says is utterly necessary. We're establishing the conventional reality of something. We have to first agree what it is. Don't just believe what people tell you, and because we do, we believe in anything. We'll believe anything anyone tells us. Complete suckers, you know? So, mummy, what do you mean it's a cup? Prove it to me. She should. If it's correct definition, she'd better prove it. So what does she do? She gets the tea and she pours like that. And we guess what? It actually does fulfill the definition. It holds my tea. Well done, but that's not enough, as His Holiness says. One more thing we have to do. We have to double check, make sure there are no other cognitions of this phenomenon in minds of ordinary beings, conventional agreements that contradict that. Once we've established there aren't, we can all sign the contract, you know, tick the box, shake hands, and agree that's a cup, conventionally. And we have to do this first. We have to do this first. First establish what it is, conventionally. Now, eye consciousness, therefore, this has added an interesting point here, your eye consciousness does not see a pretty cup. I would say, indeed, you know, this cup suits my eyes, I'd say it's a pretty cup. But my eyes don't see it. My eyes see shape and colour. My mental consciousness is triggered, my memory comes up, it's a cup, and based on my taste that I've cultivated over my life, it's this, and I know it's a dragon, and that's red. I can recognize all the millions of pieces there, and all together this picture comes in my mental consciousness, and then what happens is this. This is all reasonable. They're all valid things to do. They are valid states of mind. That's a dragon. That's a cup. That's a handle. It's even valid to say that I like that cup. Nothing wrong with that. So where's the problems? When you take my cup and I freak out, what causes the problem? That's one of the many delusions in the hierarchy of these neuroses, this one that comes all the time, called attachment. And this is now the problem. So saying it's a cup, tick, check, perfect, nothing wrong. the conventional truths, but now the delusion starts sticking their nose in. So attachment, spontaneously, simultaneously, because it's my cup, you know, and mummy gave it to me, or it's my special grandma's antique cup, or it appeals to me a lot, then attachment takes over. Attachment sneaks its nose in, and it completely covers the cup and makes it look way more divine and special than it really is. So all the delusions, in other words, exaggerate. So, and the trouble is, we can't distinguish it's between it's being a good cup. It might have won the cup at the cup show, you know? It might have won the best cup at the cup show. Do you understand? That's a valid statement. It could be the best cup, professionally, from the point of view of cup design. That's a valid conventional truth. But we can't see the difference between it's being a good cup and a good cup and a my cup, and it is a cup, even a cup, and a totally divine, delicious cup. We can't see the difference because attachment completely takes over and covers the whole thing. And we can't see what that attachment is doing. And then the cup that appears to my eyes and to my mind is this divine, delicious, special, wow, wow cup. It's a lie, Buddha says. That's an ordinary lie to see. Let's say you can't stand that cup. It doesn't suit your taste. Or let's say I'm your ex-girlfriend. So you just look at the cup and it reminds you of me and you can't stand the sight of it. You go, ugh, what an ugly cup. You know? Now you can't distinguish that what you've added to the mix is the delusion called aversion, which makes the cup look disgusting. You can't see your mind doing that. We can't see the difference. All these states of mind kind of come together like a big soup, you know? We have no awareness of what our mind is doing. So attachment comes along and exaggerates the deliciousness of the cup. Your aversion comes along and exaggerates the ugliness of the cup. Now this we can recognize. We can see that we do this. Now, the root delusion, this ego grasping, or ignorance, this deepest lie, the most primordial lie that informs all the other lies, that's a subtler lie, more pervasive lie, more primordial lie. And this one we can't even begin to see. And this is the one we're going to now start talking about, because this is now where emptiness comes in. This lie exaggerates the very, you could say, ontological status of the delicious cup in the first place. This is too abstract for our minds, you know? But we can look into it. We have to. I'll drink out of my cup. Okay. Now let's discuss the existence of another phenomenon conventionally. And that phenomenon is called I. From the point of view of this world, you know, the people... these people sitting in this room on a cushion, on a chair, we're known as the phenomenon called a person. This is a phenomenon called a cup. That's a saucer. That's a clock. A cloth. There's a clock. There's an iPad, you know? All these things. We understand this. So this is a person. The word person, the word I, the word self, these are all synonymous. We're one of those. We're an example of a person. Okay. So the word we use mostly is I, isn't it? This is the big deal. I. So conventionally speaking, there does exist, sitting in this chair, a person, an I. There does exist, sitting here in this room, a bunch of persons sitting on chairs and cushions. This is conventionally a statement of truth. You know, like the cup. You establish it. We agree, the definition, we fit the definition of being a person. I forget the definition of a person. What's the definition of a person?
That which is imputed.
I know, it's a ridiculous definition though, isn't it? I mean, it's a stupid definition. I won't even give it to you. It's just like, I know, that's one of those.
Label.
I know. So we forget the definition. That which is imputed on the thing that fits to be a person. Like, thanks.
Four or five aggregates. Yeah.
There you go. Okay, all right, four or five aggregates. Whatever. Okay, it's a good definition. She knows it better than me. I forgot it. Thank you very much. Venerable here. She's a good teacher, this person. She studied very deeply, more than I have. So, okay, let's say we are a person. So now, this is the one let's talk about, this person. Okay. What Buddha is saying is this. And in the different traditions in Buddhism, the different levels in the Buddhist view, different levels of the way this ignorance grasps at this sense of self, self-grasping, ego-grasping. That's the name of this ignorance when it comes to this object. We can say like that. And it grasps at this sense of an I. The Buddha says, like with a cup, exaggerating it, this ignorance exaggerates the very status of this I. This ignorance causes us to exaggerate our sense of self, making it more real, more solid, more concrete, more fixed than actually in reality it is. Of course this sounds abstract to us, you know. So like all these delusions, like I'm saying, they have this role, they have this function of exaggerating, of over-exaggerating, of making a mountain out of a molehill. So this ego grasping makes a mountain out of makes a mountain about the I, over-exaggerates its status. And the way we know that functions in our daily life is I did this and I did that and you said that to me and I'm no good and I'm happy and I'm sad and I'm hungry and I'm this. We can all see that this word I is the absolute central player in all of our lives, you know. So naturally, when we say a word, we assume there's an object out there, there's a referent object for that word. We don't go into this, we don't analyze it. And what the Buddha is saying is that the I, that when we say the word I, what it's referring to, what we think it's referring to, what we think it's referring to, doesn't exist. At least not in the way we think. It's distorting and exaggerating, over-exaggerating our status. That's what he's saying. And that's the deepest cause of all the suffering. On the basis of that I, of the fantasy, the exaggerating of the very status of the I, we then have attachment to get what the I wants, then we get angry when the I doesn't get what it wants, and so on and so forth, all the other dramas. So we'll leave that for a minute, and now we'll open a new chapter, and we'll now look at the word. Now let's put all this together, and now we look at the word emptiness and how it's used, because this is our biggest problem. We hear, you know, we know all this stuff, we've been studying Buddhism, blah, 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 and we hear that we've got to realize emptiness, and we get lost. We think it's some in the sky, it's an alternative to God, it's like some absolute thing, it's like, who knows what it means, you know? And it's just the way they use the term, we've got to get used to it, you know? So let's just look at the word itself now. We'll turn the page. So, okay. We actually use this phrase they talk a lot about. We use it in our daily life. So we will go, I'll go, oh no, my cup is empty. We say that, don't we? My cup is empty. Well, we all know what it means. It just means empty of tea. You look in the room, you go, oh, the room's empty. Empty of people. We know that. We talk this way. You look in your bank account, oh no, my bank account's empty. We all know that one. We know it means of dollars. So speaking really simply, what's that saying is, there is something that does exist that lacks something else. There's something that does exist that lacks something else. There's something that does exist that lacks something else. Well, Buddha talks just the same way. He says the eye and the cup and the saucer and the cloth lack what they call inherent existence. So don't even worry what that means yet. Don't worry about what that means yet. We'll discuss it in a minute. But the concept of something that does exist, an I, conventionally, that lacks something else. So it gets a bit tricky because what that I is lacking is a certain kind of existence that he calls inherent existence that he says it doesn't possess. But whoever thought it did? I mean, this is where it's kind of confusing to us. It's like saying your cup is empty of ooh-ha. Well, you don't know what ooh-ha is. So what good is knowing about there's no ooh-ha in your cup? You've got to learn what ooh-ha is first, right? You agree? So we've got to know what inherent existence means. That's the trouble. We'll leave it for now. We won't worry about that. But it's this concept. There's something that does exist. And by the way, what does exist is so subtle, it's as if it doesn't. As Lama Zopa puts it, but we'll go into that. But simply speaking, conventionally, there is a person that lacks, that is empty of, a thing called, a status, a way of existing, called inherent existence. Again, don't worry what it means. This is the way they talk. Everything that exists, Buddha says, is empty of existing inherently. Whatever exists, green, colour, and carpets, and cloths, and persons, and clocks, and cups, and iPads and pee-pee and caca and you name it, whatever we can establish as conventionally existent is empty of inherent existence. We'll discuss that in a minute. But it's the phrase. We're used to it. So as it says on the Heart Sutra, Buddha's wonderful little, sweet little talk about emptiness. Basically the Heart Sutra's listing all these categories of phenomena. You know, the first one is the five aggregates. You know, it's a way of Buddha's presenting the way we broke it up into five bits and pieces. And the first bit that he talks about is what's called form, which is really referring to the physical. So he would say, it says in the Heart Sutra, form is emptiness. Emptiness is form. Form is nothing other than emptiness. Emptiness is nothing other than form. What it's saying is that form is empty of inherent existence. And if it's to have emptiness, you've got to have form. So to have emptiness of water, you've got to have a cup. To have emptiness of inherent existence, there's got to be an I that's empty in the first place. So you've got to have a conventional thing that lacks another thing. It's a simple way of saying that's the next point. So the next point is this. What does it mean, realize emptiness, which sounds abstract? Well, it's like this. If you are totally convinced, there's $5,000 in your savings account. Completely convinced. You've been saving it, you're expecting it, you can practically taste it. And you go online, you put your password in, and what there is written is in fact a zero. Now I promise you, you will not see a zero. You will see, you'll go, oh my God, there's no $5,000. Won't you? Won't you do that? If I didn't know there was $5,000 in your account and you said to me, look on my account and tell me how much is there, because I don't expect $5,000, I will just say the truth, the zero. But you will see the absence of $5,000. You will see the emptiness of $5,000, and that'll be the most vivid thing for you to cognize, won't it? Can you get that? Like if I believe my delicious, wonderful, perfect, best, delicious cafe latte is in my cup, and I'm waiting to drink it, I'll go there and I'll drink, I'll get a shock, won't I? I won't see, my cup's empty. I won't just go think there's nothing there. All I will notice is the emptiness of my cafe latte, won't I? If you're convinced there's $5 in your pocket, completely convinced, and you whip your hand in, you'll get a shock when you find there will be nothing in your pocket, but you won't just see nothing in your pocket. You will find the emptiness of $5. It's a vivid phenomenon for your mind, isn't it? Can you hear this? That's how they talk about emptiness. So that's why it's got zero to do with just being nothing in your pocket. Oh, well, there's no dollars in the bank. Oh, well, there's no water in my cup. Oh, well, there's no $5. There's nothing in my pocket. No, that's nihilism. So the absence, in other words, all this business of experiencing, of understanding, of realizing emptiness is you get this massive shock when you see it for the first time, that, as Lama Zopa puts it, when you have your first moment in your meditation, it's got to be at the subtle level of your mind, of the first moment of your direct, clear insight into the emptiness, the absence, that's all it means, absence of the I that you have thought has been there since beginningless time, that it isn't. You don't merely go, oh, well, there's no I. That's nihilism. You will get the shock of your life when you finally discover the emptiness, the absence, the lack of that rich, powerful thing that you have always thought was there, but in fact isn't and has never been. So the absence of something is the way to hear it, not just nothing. And our trouble is, though, when we listen to this presentation of the two truths as we hear Buddha's teachings, the conventional cup, the final or ultimate, is the absence of the inherent cup. There's conventional cup, and then ultimately there's the emptiness of the inherent cup. Of course, we don't know that we think there's an inherent cup there. We never thought we thought an inherent cup. We've never heard of such a concept. So we've got to learn it. And that's the key. If you don't know, if you know what $5 is, it's easy to see the absence of it in your pocket. It's easy. You've got a realization immediately. Our problem is we haven't got a clue what an inherent I would be if it did exist. We just believe in it. We don't know we believe in it. But Buddha says we've been believing in it since beginningless time, and it is the source of all suffering, period. So it's already so abstract for us. So we can never begin to understand emptiness of an inherent I until you know what an inherent I would be. You can never know the emptiness of ooh-ha in your cup until you know what an ooh-ha is. It's sort of obvious. If you don't know what $5 is, and I say, please would you go and find my $5, I left it on the couch. You could search for 40 million years. But until you learn what $5 is, you will never find the absence of $5. Now, $5 is easy because $5 could exist. Water could exist. $1,000 could exist. But inherent I never could exist. It's more dramatic. So it's more abstract for us. So the first thing we have to do, one of the first jobs we have to do in order to understand even intellectually the emptiness of an inherent I on the I that does exist, is to even get a sense of what we think an inherent I would be like if it did exist, because it can't exist. So it's quite tricky. So you've got to know what it's referring to, then you've got to search for it, and then you finally will prove it isn't there. And that's when you recognize the absence of it. So we've got to get our head around that concept, how we can talk about the absence of something. And we know it, we talk about it all the time. Like if your boyfriend just leaves you, and you're at home, all you ever notice all day is the emptiness of your boyfriend, isn't it? It's painful. But if I didn't know you have a boyfriend, I walk in the house, I'm not going to notice the absence of Fred, because I didn't know Fred was there in the first place. So the absence, in this context, the seeing the absence of something is only valid for the person who thought the thing was there in the first place. And this is the point. Buddha's saying, we have believed since beginningless time that there is right here, this is a grosser level of it, right here among all these bits and pieces, within the parameters of this person in this chair, the parts, the body and the mind, we have been thus absolutely convinced 1,000,000,000% since beginning this time that there does exist a piece, a part, like my friend Penday says, walking hand in hand with the other pieces, a piece called I. This is not even the grossest understanding. This is not even the subtlest understanding of it. In other words, when Buddha presents these different teachings, the different levels of understanding, how we think there's this, you know, a simple word for inherent, a simple word here that we can understand is a word called independent. He says we believe there's a part in here, along with the other parts, but like a boss part, like the landlord part, like the main part, like the boss. The part called I, that is, and this is the point, that's independent of, separate from the other bits. He says we believe that totally. Again, this is not the subtlest meaning, but this is so tasty. We talk like this. Everything we say is reaffirming this belief, and he says it's nonsense. There's no such piece that's separate from the other pieces that's called I. But our language expresses it, doesn't it? I have a nose, I'll say. I have a body, we'll say. I have a mind, we'll say. And so we instinctively, we don't articulate it, that's what we have to do. We instinctively believe, when we say I, it's pointing to some part in there, but we never quite point out where it is. We're never quite sure. But we're very convinced it's there that owns a body and owns a mind. Such that if you were to point them out, you'd have to point out a part called the body, a part called the mind, and the third part called the eye. And as Lama Zopa puts it, if that's true, well, that's great. The eye can stay at home having fun, and the body and the mind can go to work. But we think this is silly, you know? Because we're so convinced that it is there. So when we hear something like that, it just sounds, what? Who? What are you trying to say, you know? Are we communicating here? Yes. The point of this is not just being clever. Buddha's not being clever. This is real experience for the yogis. This is real experience for the people who've seen it, who know it. And so the key point of all this is, what's the consequence of this? Well, I'll tell you. Bliss, happiness, fearlessness. There is no fear, as Lama Zopa says. When you've cut the belief in the fantasy eye, there is no fear. That's it. Hear those words, people. all the other delusions crumble into crumble into dust. They have no basis anymore. There's fearlessness, courage, joy. You're delight. You're amazing. You're a fun person to be around. You love. You're happy. You're smiling. You're laughing. You're kind. You're compassionate. You're wise. You're huge. You're courageous. No attachment. No neurosis. No depression. No jealousy. No low self-esteem. And no none of the rubbish. This is Buddha's deal. It's shocking, but that's what he says. You know. And he says everybody can accomplish this. It's just hard work. That's all. So the consequence is happiness. Speaking simply. The consequence is freedom from suffering, which sounds kind of abstract, but that's how they talk, you know. Who wouldn't want that? I'm looking forward to it. So any questions, please? What time do we have to finish? 8 o'clock? 9 o'clock? 8. What time we finish?
8:30.
Okay. Any questions? Okay.
Whenever I hear this,
Where are you? Oh, okay, good.
I'm sorry.
Go.
Whenever I hear this, I think of people who, in my mind, are genuinely suffering, say from a painful disease.
Yeah.
Or I think of the people of Tibet, and what the Chinese have done to them.
Yeah.
Is that not real suffering?
Is it not so? Okay, speaking strictly, yes, the only reason anyone would suffer in the way Buddha defines suffering is because we have ego. Yes, that's exactly right. That's exactly right. Literally, you would say that. The reason we experience suffering is because we believe in the I and have all the other dramas as a result. Because you can say literally a person. Okay, let's talk about the Dalai Lama. As we know, he's said to be a Buddha. I wouldn't have a clue if he's a Buddha, but let's just say he is. So he cries when he sees his suffering people, right? So we have a very bigger meaning. We have a different meaning of suffering. When we see him cry, we would assume that's suffering. But that's called compassion. That's not suffering. That's not possible. So you could argue it's not possible for him to be suffering. Utterly impossible, if he is who he is. But he has immense compassion. Immense love, immense wisdom, immense. There's no way there could be suffering. No way, not impossible. Utterly, completely, and totally impossible in the way Buddha defines suffering. And this is why it's such an abstract concept for us, because in our models of the mind, in our philosophies, in our world, there is no such possibility. You know, we even say to say that you can get rid of all anger, all attachment, all fears, and therefore all suffering is insane to us. So it's quite hard to hear that this is what Buddha is saying. So yes, literally there wouldn't be suffering if you had, not just, you know, you first have your first moment of realizing emptiness, you've got way to go before you removed all the obstacles from your mind. But from there, at least you can't fall back. And as Rinpoche says, in general, when you realize emptiness, there is no fear. There wouldn't be suffering. Literally, yes. Which doesn't mean you sit there laughing while your friends are suffering. No, you'd have compassion and you'd be crying, there'd be blood coming if you get cut. Understand, but there wouldn't be what we call suffering. There can't be. Do you see? Are you hearing the words? What does it say to you? Does it confuse you?
I still have difficulty wrapping around the concept of a person being treated badly, a person feeling genuine pain, someone being tortured.
You say that like everybody, or normal people, of course we suffer. But we're talking about a person who's got realizations. Okay, let me tell you. Kirti Senchab Rinpoche, one of these lamas, said one point, he says this, and I forget even what level. There's levels of realizations. You realize that, don't you? There are stages and levels of realizations,
of course,
all the way to Buddhahood. Okay, he says, I forget what level, but a certain level, bodhisattva. Let's assume a person who has realized emptiness, who is what they call an Arya bodhisattva, who has got enormous compassion for others. He said, for that bodhisattva, the action of cutting off his hand and feeding it to a starving animal is as inconsequential as a leaf falling off a tree. Of course we can't comprehend that. It's not fitting in our world. It's not fitting in our experience. And who created all our models of the mind in our culture? Because there are people like you and me who believe in an I and believe in all this suffering. So there's nobody in our culture who posits such things because it's not within our realm of existence. That's why we assume it's just fantasy. Do you see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm.
I think so.
What do you mean you think so? Of course you hear what I'm saying. I'm not asking you to believe it, honey. But can you hear the
I
words?
I have met one of these people.
Pardon?
I have not met one of these people.
No, excuse me, you probably have, but you don't recognize because you just put ordinary meaning onto people. The bodhisattvas hanging out all over the place, the beggars down the road, the smelly homeless person. We can't see, we're as thick as posts. We just see what our mind sees because we've got delusions. Tibetans say you don't know who anybody is, so we shouldn't judge. So that's another whole level, you know. We project what we have in our mind onto people, don't we? And even if we did meet somebody, I mean, you meet the Dalai Lama, you know, you can see he's a fun guy. He cracks jokes, he's funny, he's down to earth, he's wonderful. Who can see a Buddha? Not possible. Not possible to see a Buddha. Buddhas don't need bodies. They're way, way, way beyond bodies. So when they kindly come down and take a bag of bones looking like us, they're going to look like us and act like us and have constipation and wear glasses. They look like regular guys. Of course they don't look like a Buddha. We don't know what a Buddha means. Do you see? Okay. Any other questions? Yes.
Venerable Robina, thank you for coming to teach us.
Oh, pleasure, yeah.
So, for us who live here in the first world, we become so, or at least I become very absorbed in my things.
And of course yet, we do. That's our nature, isn't it?
And yet, I understand that that's one of the... greatest sufferings is all the
what
things
is?
That I'm attached to.
Attachment. Now, the things aren't the problem. The attachment is.
Okay.
Now, really be clear. It's not the things that are the problem. It's not money and husbands and wives and babies that are the problem. It's the attachment. That's the problem. And that's everywhere, not just in the first world.
So what is the fastest, easiest way to let go of them?
Huh?
What's the fastest, easiest way to let go of my grasping?
What do you want a fast, easy way for?
Because I'm a Westerner. We like it fast and easy.
Well, you won't find one, so give up. Don't worry. You won't find one. There's no fast, easy. So do you want to know the answer still?
Yes.
Okay. You start at the beginning of the path and you learn to control your body and your speech. You do what your grandma says. Behave nicely. So entry level, junior school for the Buddha, given that whatever we do with our body and speech is driven by attachment, then you calm your body and speech down. You don't shove every piece of cake in your mouth. You don't buy everything you feel like. You don't jump on every girl you fancy. You don't say every word that you feel. You don't abuse everyone you don't like. You control your body and speech, and this is a stupendously hard job already. And then what you're doing there is, you know, stopping harming others, and they're going to, as Lama Zopa says, all the rats and roaches will have a party. They're happy because you live in peace. But the real beneficiary is you. And now you can go to high school, and now you can start to learn to meditate, and now you can start to actually get to the root of the problem, which is your delusions, your mind. And then you really start to make progress.
Thank you.
One step at a time, darling.
Thank you.
Have confidence. No, wait. Have confidence, know it's possible, get the technique step by step. The methodology is there, it's a bit complex to us, it looks complex, but it's not. You first control your body and speech, then you can control your mind, then you can start helping others, and then you know, it's like progress, it's all laid out nicely. And it's just one step at a time. I mean, your mind is endless and beginningless anyway, so it doesn't matter, you know.
Why do I backslide so often?
Because it's just because of habits, sweetheart. Don't be depressed by that, it's okay. Don't be depressed by that. It's just natural because we're bone lazy and we're junkies. And attachment just wants good feelings, and that's normal. It's not easy to change. Buddha says it's ancient history. So we shouldn't be depressed by it, not even the slightest. You should then do a bit of assessment of your good qualities. The fact that you come here as opposed to down to the gun club and kill people. The fact that you're not in there with Donald Trump, you know, beating people up. And anyway, excuse me, Donald Trump, he's a nice man, I'm sure. You understand that you're not bashing people up and trying to shoot them, and be happy that all the bad things you're not doing. Just then you look at the little problems. I mean, you're not a psychopath, right? You're not a terrorist. You're not a pedophile. You're not a thief. You're not a murderer. Well, you're doing really well, baby. Rejoice in your good qualities.
Thank you.
And it takes time. Just you fall down, you pick yourself up, and you say, oh, I'm going to keep moving. You just got to give up and have optimism. There is no shortcut. But have humility and patience and perseverance and rejoice in your good qualities. If we don't, we will destroy ourselves with misery. All right? Okay. Over here. Here we go. Yes.
I don't even know if I'm asking this right, but emptiness, right?
Yep.
So the way I can see it, like right now, and I'm new at this, so I don't know. is I can start here. Let's say I'm upset.
What?
Let's say I'm upset about something.
Yep.
And I can think about it, and I can start taking it apart, and I can feel that sense of upsetness in me that I'm clinging to starting to evaporate.
That's right.
It gives me a clue.
That's right.
Is there a way to start from the other way?
Which other way?
Like,
what do you mean?
Rather than taking things apart, like seeing it build up rather than apart. Or am I not asking this right? In other words, I do all my meditations on emptiness. Here's what I'm feeling. And I can kind of see the parts to it.
But that's good. That's what you should do. That's good. But there is a nice way of building up. You mean to try and establish. What are you trying to establish by doing it the other way?
Like I said, I don't know if I'm asking.
No, it's fine. Just say it. What would you want?
Instead of taking something
apart
to build it up.
You want to try and construct something to see.
Construct something to see if there's a false eye.
Okay, good. Yeah, let's do it.
Is there a way to do that?
There's a particular way I like to do that. It's a very nice way to do it. A different approach. Okay. You would agree this is called Robina's holding a cup in her right hand. Wouldn't you agree that this is the name of this action? We all know the meaning of those words. We all agree on the definitions. We go tick, tick, tick. Robina's holding a cup in her right hand. But let's say I've lost my memory and all the memory of what to do. So if you had to start writing down all the instructions and for me what to do, it'd be the biggest list of IKEA parts in the whole world, wouldn't it? Do you understand? You'd have to write down, you have to write down what is a cup, then the thumb and the finger and the middle one and the little finger and then the ligaments and the joints. You'd write all these lists down because these are the parts, aren't they? Are they not the parts that are all playing a role here? The cup, then all the millions of bits which depend on each piece and the wrist and then this bone here and you have to do this one, the elbow here and your shoulder here, you hold this one. Would you agree? And you'd eventually exhaust the list, wouldn't you, of all the bits and pieces of the body that are involved in the action called Robina is holding the cup in her right hand. First of all, would you agree with that? And you'd have a lot of pieces, wouldn't you? You'd have a lot of pieces, wouldn't you, of the body. Now, we can see the main part that's really running the show is the mind, isn't it? Because a dead body would not be able to do that. So now we look at the mind. And what are the parts of the mind? Well, the very first one has to be the thought called intention, which is the real meaning of karma. Intention says, I will hold the cup. That's what it says. It's the first thought. Then you have to have attention, which then pays attention and starts putting all these millions of bits and pieces together. Attention. Then you have to have all the other bits of the mind. One is called good memory, so you don't forget to drop and you drop it. One is called vigilance. One is called recognition. This is a crucial one that's got to be able to distinguish between cup, joint, middle finger, little finger, and all the millions of bits and pieces. There's many parts of your mind, okay, that are all working together spontaneously because we've trained it for countless lives, and we do now instinctively. But there's millions of pieces there. If you really had to write a list, it would be hundreds of pages. Could you agree with that?
Yeah.
The many parts of your mind, all the thoughts, you agree? The many parts of your body, you agree? And all of this would bring up the action called Robina's holding a cup in her right hand. You agree? Now, have you noticed that I haven't yet mentioned a part called I? Have you noticed that? And Buddha says you don't need one. Because all the bits do very nicely on their own. Thank you. That's why he says we don't need a creator. From the bigger picture, the macro picture is, you know, if you're a Muslim or a Christian, not being rude if you are, please excuse me, Buddha thinks it's okay to discuss this stuff. We believe one of the first things the Muslims always say is, oh, I've got to be an architect, it's all so amazing. And we all assume that with the eye. Well, this is also amazing, there's got to be a part of me that is running the show, the boss, which we think is the eye. We think there's got to be a creator who holds all the pieces together. Buddha says, no, all the billions of consciousnesses are all doing their own trips. That's enough. That's called karma. You don't need a boss holding it together. We don't need a boss eye running the show. All the bits of the mind, all the bits of the body, all work hand in hand. And there's millions of parts of the body that do all the jobs that we think an eye does, but we don't need an eye to do it because the parts of the mind themselves do it. Do you see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And you keep looking and you keep searching. And then you go, well, what role would an eye have that isn't done by the mind? Of course, it's the mind that's the main one. And you keep looking, and you're always going to find a part of the mind that's called the mental factors. They call them mental factors that does that job. Intention, attention, recognition, this one. There's millions. It's highly sophisticated, this model of the mind, which is not how we think in the West, because we're talking the thoughts, not the brain. Do you see? Is that helpful?
Yes, Mary.
I find that very tasty. What do you think? keep looking and keep trying to find a piece that was an eye. Keep finding a job that the other bits aren't doing. And you keep looking and you keep looking and you keep looking. Buddha says you'll never find one because you don't need one. It's an unnecessary bell and whistle that we have made up. Yes.
So when we're aware of that, we're grasping at that delusional eye.
Yep. All the time, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. Just habit.
So what's the next instant? How we can help ourselves? The next instant after the awareness that, oh,
well,
oh,
one, okay,
here it is. I'm hooked. Hook's coming at me. You know, I'm about.
This is the part. This is the difficult part. You see, there's so much work we have to do first in order to know what to do the next second. So one of the first things, the key thing, like they say, one of the classic ways in the Lam Rim that's presented, is the four-point analysis. The methods that's used, a classic method, they all say it's the easiest, but this shows where we're at, because for us it's so difficult. And when you say, it's like, you know, have you studied the Lam Rim? You know what you're talking, right? Mm-hmm. You're studying the Lam Rim and everything? Here?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Are you? Yeah, okay. And you've studied Pabongka Rinpoche's book, Liberation? Mm-hmm. You study that here? Okay, in this section, he says that a really simple approach to understanding emptiness is the four-point analysis. But we've got to remember who he's talking to. People in his audience who've been studying this stuff for 40 years. So they're ahead of the game. You know, for them, it's easy. So we've got to get some context here. For us, we've done none of the background work, you know. And until we study the mind in more depth, until we study and understand all these different states of mind the Buddha talks about that are all playing these crucial roles in our lives, you understand what I'm trying to say here?
Yes.
Until you even know that, and then the understanding, you've got to have an understanding of delusions, you've got to know there are virtues, you've got to know there are the other ones. There's millions of these thoughts. We've got to have some ability to even recognize first intellectually that all these thoughts. And then we have to understand, beginning by knowing our mind every day. Forget trying to see the ego grasping. Look at the attachment when it arises. Look at the anger when it arises. Look at the fear when it arises. Look at all the other little baby voices in there all chatting away. We've got to recognize them. Already this is stupendous. Lama Zopa says, the vast majority of human beings on this earth have absolutely no idea that what goes on in their mind plays any role at all in their lives. So to even know you've got a mind, and then the difficult part is to know the names of the pieces that you're experiencing. This is the difficult one, the most difficult to see the ego grasping. It's the most difficult to see, the subtlest. So all the other work is what we have to do for years. Do you understand? To inform this job. So, in answer to your question, they all say the best time to grab it all is when a really bad thing happens. Like a car nearly runs over you. The guy comes in front of you on the freeway. Now let's look what happens normally, okay? You're driving along, most of us are unconscious, we're chatting away, unconscious of what we're thinking even, waiting to get to work, you know, blah, 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 driving, checking the traffic, you know. And then boom, some fella leaps in from the wrong lane. So the first thing arises, you get a shock because you don't see him. So the eye rises like a sleeping lion. The heart beats fast, and we call that fear, right? Now the next millisecond, we start to curse. How dare? You know, and so already you've just missed the opportunity. You've lost it. So that's where even this point, to have the training, to that when a bad thing happens, you are actually glad. Please run in front of me again. Give me an opportunity to see the eye. You're so happy to have the opportunity. But if we miss the opportunity, it's too late because we start on the drama. He said this and she said, already you've missed it. And the millisecond we should catch it, that means we've even got to be pleased when a bad thing happens. We've got to be glad when a person insults us because we're dying for the opportunity for the eye to rise so we can see it. Do you get my point? That's
yes.
Really advanced. As soon as you start launching into the story and the self-pity and the poor me and how dare you do this, we've just lost the opportunity. It's gone. So we've got to be so advanced to even, the first point is to recognize, as they say, to recognize and to try and work out what you think the ooh-ah is. What is this thing, you know? If it did exist, what would it be? And the only time to see it, because it's so subliminal or so primordial, is when a big shock happens. So you've got to be glad to have it. And who's glad to be insulted? Nobody. Who's glad to be run over, you know, nearly driven by a mean car? We get all full of vindictiveness and how dare and blah, blah, blah. You understand?
Yes.
So it's really hard to grab it. That's really the answer. That's sophisticated. Meaning, you know, you can't, oh, please insult me again, you know, that was great. Oh, give me a chance to see the eye again, you know? Forget it. I mean, forget it. Do you understand?
Yes.
That's the one. So in general, it's, you know, it's there all the time, but it's like a sleeping lion.
Yes.
It's assumed. It's at the level of assumption. So it only rises. You know, in our culture, we call it instinct for survival. That Buddha would have liked that. That's ego grasping. Do you understand? So let me tell you a lovely story. So I'll tell you a nice story about Lama Zopa. Lama Zopa Rinpoche, you know, our boss in this of this center, this organization, you know, our teacher, one of some of us. So he was recognized. He's a Sherpa, okay? You know, one of those Sherpas. And he was, when he was a very little boy, anyway, he was recognized as a little boy as the reincarnation of a previous Nyingma yogi, a great yogi who spent like 30 years of his life in this little hole in the wall. The radishes used to be stored there. He kind of pulled the radishes out and moved in, you know, and he's known as the Radish Lama, Lao Tzu Lama. Anyway, whatever. The point is, he died according to these great, you know, this Tibetan tradition. They learned to control the whole death process. We're going to discuss that this weekend and choose their next rebirth. That's what they say, okay? So he was a real little boy. As soon as the mother would turn her back, little Zopa would be crawling up the hill, right, to his to where they knew the cave was, before he could even talk. So they'd drag him home. And then he'd start to walk and talk, and he'd be walking up the hill, you know, as soon as mummy turned her back. "Come home," she'd say. He'd say, "No, that is my home." So anyway, the sister said that whenever he played games, he'd always play the role of a llama. He'd make mud pie dorjis and mud pie bells and mud pie tormas, and he'd announce that all his benefactors were coming, and he'd give the list of his names. They're all his past life benefactors. So mummy figured she'd better check up on who he is, you know. So she checks the local llamas, and they deduce he must be the reincarnation. They have all these methods of the Lao Tzu Lama. Anyway, the story is this. So the assumption is he was the reincarnation of a highly evolved being who'd realized emptiness, who knew all this stuff, and they don't lose it. These little ones, when they've got it and they die well, they don't lose these realizations. They retain them, and they retain their memory when they're little. So let's just assume he's like that. Okay, he's 8 years old, he said, and he's up in the mountain in some monastery with his manager. They always talk about they have managers. They're very professional, these people. Whatever. And he sees across this big river these very strange-looking foreigners, these pale-faced people with straw-colored hair and pale eyes. Sounds like white people, okay? White people. He'd never met white people before. So he was very fascinated, and he wanted to meet them. So the bridge was rickety and not very safe, but he's determined to go. So he brought a bowl of potatoes, and he's walking across, and he falls in the river. Well, I mean, they don't teach them swimming up there, you know? So he's drowning. And as he said, his head would come up to the top, and he'd see his manager running frantically along the bank, you know. But then he said to himself, "Ah," he said, "the thought occurred to me. The person known as the Lao Tzu Lama is about to die," he said to himself as he's struggling for air. Then he said, "Well, I didn't know anything about emptiness," which meant in that life he'd never heard about it, "but there was no fear." So this is exactly the point, you know. When you've cut this primordial, instinctive belief in an independent I, like the one running the show, which we have believed since the beginning of time, Buddha says, and in the whole Buddhist view, this is the source of all suffering, all happiness, all even the relative happiness we have, all rebirths, everything. It's a vast view, okay? When you've cut that one, then all the others crumble in this hierarchy. There's no longer a basis for attachment in the other rubbish, and depending on how advanced you are, when you've cut that, this is what's so hard for us to hear, then there's no longer any suffering, therefore fear. Fear, you see, is the taste, is the main flavor of all those delusions. And we know this. Look at your ordinary life. Attachment, depression, jealousy, always worried, always fearful, wanting this, not wanting that, worried about this, can't do that, too fat, too thin, or our entire world, even if we're nice people. It's like neurotic, you know. Fear is the main flavor of all these delusions, and it's the main taste of the root one. So this instinct for survival, we would assume that unless Lama Zopa had instinct for survival, which would be massive fear that would drive him to the top of the water and would cause him to grip and grasp to stay alive, they assume he would sink to the bottom of the river like a stone and go, "Oh, well, I'm dying. What does it matter?" No, Buddha says. You don't need that stupid looking rubbish. It's called ego grasping, which indeed is instinct for survival, which is complete primordial panic, and it will do anything. It'll trample over everybody to get what it wants. That's the cause of all the suffering. When that's gone, he still went to the water, the top of the water for air. He still wanted, but his, the point is, his mind wasn't disturbed. This is insane to us. And as he said, huh, the thought occurred to me. Not I am going to die, but the person known as the Laodo Lama is about to die. But there was no fear. I think it's most interesting, isn't it?
Quick question.
Isn't that interesting? You people? Thank you very much. Okay. Gives me some encouragement to keep going. Hang on, who was talking first? Which one are you guys?
Okay.
Okay, go.
A couple of weeks ago when we were meditating on the eye and trying to see if we could somehow pull it out and set it over to the side and see that it existed over there. And during that, when I was trying to do that, I experienced this feeling of like, trying to, you know, pulling out the ego, what I call the ego, and then I was left with this emptiness. Well, not the same kind of emptiness, more of a fear. You know, there was nothing left, and I just wanted to if you
fear
would
is good.
Comment.
Fear is a very good. Rinpoche says not to be afraid of the fear. Don't kind of launch, hold on to it. It's good to let that happen. Because, you know, they say the lower level yogi, who when he has his first realization of emptiness, would have fear, incredible fear. The higher level realization would be blissful. You've discovered there's no I in the first, the I that you always thought was there. So there's nothing wrong with fear. It depends on how you know how to deal with it, you know. That's good. Good sign. Nothing wrong.
Can I follow up with real quick?
What?
Can I follow up with a different question? One way I realize the I, or I think I'm realizing it, is to think of those times when I'm really nervous in front of speaking in front of people.
That's right.
You know, and that feeling that, you know, your heart beating
fast.
That's
right, exactly.
And you're sweating.
Strong sense of I, isn't it? Yeah.
Right. And I wondered if, do you still feel that at all? Do you ever experience that? And, when was the last time you did?
It was different, isn't it? Oh, of course I feel the sense of I. When you insult me and don't do what I want, I get very upset. Of course I do. I mean, this is my job, and Lama Zoba told me to do the job years ago, and I remember thinking two things. I was thinking, what if I get nervous, and then what if I run out of words? I'd have those two fears, you know? Mm-hmm. Then I decided if I run out of words, I'll just go, okay, ask me some questions, which is still what I do. And if I always decide if I'm talking to one person, you don't get afraid. So I decide I'll talk naturally as if I'm talking to one person. So I don't get nervous. It's just but different people. One of my friends is a really scholar. He has to prepare for hours. He doesn't talk. He says it's really difficult for him. So we've all got different natures, haven't we? But of course there's going to be fear at one level or another until we completely realize emptiness. Of course there is. It's natural.
Thank you.
Good. Okay. Yes.
Hey, you're really interesting.
What, sweetheart?
You're really interesting.
I'm interesting. Oh, God, I'm glad. Yeah. Well, good, darling.
Thank you for teaching, and thank you for following the Buddhist path.
Oh, sweetheart, I'm totally enjoying it.
I can tell. So, I have all these concepts and teachings about emptiness.
Yes.
But I don't understand. I haven't realized emptiness. So how do I realize emptiness? What are some meditations I could do?
Do you recognize in your mind states of mind like fear?
Yeah.
Jealousy?
Yeah.
Loneliness?
Yeah.
Attachment? Depression? Well then, darling, join the club. That's called We're All in Samsara. And that proves that we believe in the I, okay? So then the first step is to start to recognize those states of mind and know how they over-exaggerate, how they're distortions. When we're depressed, we think we're hopeless, don't we? Would you agree?
Yeah.
When you're angry, you think the other person's hopeless, right? Isn't it? You understand? You agree? You agree?
Yeah.
So even this one, to start to realize that those states of mind that do make us miserable are exaggerating. They're over-exaggerating. They're overstating something. If we can begin to do that, that's an amazing stepping stone to get to the deeper lie that over-exaggerates the very existence of everything. So one step at a time, sweetheart.
Second.
What, darling?
Say again.
What?
Say again.
Say it again?
Yeah.
Oh, I forget. You had to listen to the recording. Darling, are you practicing all this stuff?
Yeah.
Well then, honey, keep moving. It's all right. You're doing great. Just keep moving, darling. Just one step at a time. You see your mind a little bit? Do you want to be a happy guy?
Yeah.
You want to be less neurotic?
Yeah.
Well then, honey, you're doing the job. So one step at a time, darling.
Thank you.
Be happy with it. Really, I'm serious now.
Okay.
It's like, I think if we can begin to even recognize that we've got thoughts and feelings and emotions and that they are the source of our pain and happiness, you are like the 0.1% of this earth, baby. Not the rich, but the fortunate. So be so happy that you're even able to do that. It's incredible. And if you keep moving, it will all come and it'll all fall into place. So be patient and never give up. Okay?
Okay, thank you.
Good, darling. Who else? Who else? Someone else. Yes.
Does that subtle level of, this is kind of a three-part question, but that subtle level.
I think
level
it mightn't be on, I'm not sure.
I'll get closer. Okay. That most subtle level of consciousness, does that inherently exist? And is that what is searching for?
I understand.
The realization of emptiness?
I understand.
And then, say, you're becoming familiar with emptiness. What do you do with that?
I understand.
It seems like you can go down and you might get a better sense of it, and then it fades away and you keep moving back.
I understand. So the first part of your question, is the subtle level of your mind inherently existent? That gets us, there's a whole series of assumptions in your question, and I understand that. But I think we have to look again at the meaning of inherent. Because until we have that, I think the meaning of, we hear inherent as somehow like something special that really exists. Because your assumption is subtle consciousness is better than gross consciousness, right? Not like that. Not like that at all. Okay. The Buddha would say that whatever exists, the most disgusting, the most evil, to the most sublime, is all equal. They're all equal insofar as they all exist interdependently. So the opposite to inherent, just use the best word for inherent here is independent. What Buddha's saying is, we believe there's a little I that's independent of causes, independent of parts, and finally, independent of even the mind calling it that. There's different levels. So independence is a simple word, okay? So obviously he says nothing can exist independently. It's sort of obvious. A cup's made up of many bits, a saucer, everything, you know, interdependence is how things exist. It's a very general way of saying it. We kind of see it, you know? Nothing is an island. We say nothing. What do we say? Nothing's an island. What do we say?
No man is an island.
That means you don't exist on your own. We're all dependent on everything. In the most simple meaning of this word, we can see it. Isn't it? Nothing can be independent. So that's all Buddha's saying. Interdependence is the conventional way things exist. And he's got a lot of ways of saying that. So the particular way we're talking here, we said the one example of independence, we believe there's an I that's independent of the parts. Like, you understand, a separate piece. That's one example of independence. And all he's saying is there can't be an independent anything. The nothing that exists, subtle, gross, a hell realm, Buddhahood, you name it, everything exists interdependently. That's a very general way to say it. Therefore, there can't be anything independent. Nothing can be independent. So subtle consciousness can't be. Nothing can. So it's not as if inherent is special or subtle is special. Whatever exists has to exist in dependence upon something. And of course the Buddha's expertise is the depth of the way they analyze this way that things exist interdependently. And that's the key thing we have to understand. You with me?
Yes.
All right, darling. The one we're using one example here, the one I said about the boss eye, is the one that's independent of the other parts. Do you understand my point? Well, there's another good example there, a nice little discussion to do that helps us see this one. Okay, I'll do this one. So would you agree if I say the statement, I have A saucer, a cup, and a clock. Can we all, we look at these things. Can you see this is true? I, one phenomenon, have a cup, second phenomenon, a saucer, third phenomenon, and a clock. Would you agree? Now, if that's a true statement, I have to show you four separate phenomena, don't I? Would you agree with that? I have to point out a clock that's not a saucer, that isn't a cup, and is not an eye. And the same for all the four. That's a reasonable thing to state, isn't it? And you can prove that conventionally that's a statement of truth. Now, I can also say that I have a nose, a hand, and a foot, can't I? And that's a statement we all understand, isn't it? And we can prove that statement, isn't it? Conventionally. But if it's going to be conventionally the same as what we just said there, you've got to point out four separate things. So we don't look into it, we can see it's true. But let's analyze it. So there's my foot. Now, would you agree my foot is independent of my hand? They're part of Robina, you know, but if you cut the foot off, my hand still does a nice job, doesn't it? Do you understand? Do you see my point? Yeah. My nose is not my hand or my foot, is it? And my hand is not my foot or my nose, is it? Do you agree? They're all equally independent, aren't they? You agree with that? Yeah. So now we have to point out an eye that is not the nose, that is not the hand, that is not the foot, and indeed is not the pee-pee, the caca, the knee, and everything else. And that's most annoying because we can see right there, we can't point out an eye that's separate from the hand, separate from the foot, and the nose, and all the other pieces. So do you think there's a part in there that could be the eye, the boss bit? What do you think? Any recommendations for what the eye could be? Where the eye in here could be? This is the type of analysis we have to do. Listen, they study this stuff for 40 years in the monasteries, and they go meditate for another 40 to do this job. Any recommendations, any suggestions of where the eye might be? The boss inside. Which would it be? Yeah. Huh?
The mind.
Okay, go. Good. So, okay, good. Go right. Good. Say it.
The mind.
Good. Okay, now let's look at this. Let's analyze. Shall we analyze? Okay. Let's start right back at the basics. Would you accept that a person is the name we give to a combination of a body and a mind? Would you agree with that? You would agree with that?
Yeah.
Okay. And I'm one of those. I'm an example of one of those. So you agree that a person is the name we give to a combination of a body and a mind. That body and mind are parts of a person. Would you agree with that? You agree. So now you're suggesting the mind is the person. You're saying that, aren't you? Pardon?
Part of it.
Like, oh, which part?
The mind is part of your body.
Yeah, but you just said the mind is the eye, is the boss, is the owner. So you're suggesting that my mind owns a mind. Is that what you're saying? If you say the mind is the eye, you're saying they're the same thing, aren't you?
Yeah.
So then that means you can use those words completely the same. Mind, and you wouldn't be able to separate them. So you're suggesting that my mind owns a mind. That I own an eye. That's not going to work so well, is it? We're talking about an eye being separate from the mind and separate from the body. We say, I have a mind, don't we? So you've got to have that's two things, isn't it? You say, I've got anger. That's two things, isn't it? So how can the eye be the mind? It can't be, can it? Because they wouldn't separate them if they were the same. So any other suggestions?
Ego?
Well, so, okay, tell me what the ego is, Joan. Define the ego, please. What is ego?
A sense of self and I.
A sense of self. And does it exist in the body or the mind? Because we've only got two parts, remember?
Yeah. I don't know where.
Go close to the mic.
I don't know where it exists.
Well, where you have to, you can't just say it. You've got to point it out.
It's that thing that comes up when
we know what that is. Hey, honey, we all accept that one. We're trying to point it out. Where would it be? What's it look like? Define if it exists. You have to find it, don't you?
Uh-huh.
So you have to first think what it looks like, and then you have to look for it.
It's the thing that comes up when I'm grasping.
No, we know that, but the Buddha would say that's a feeling in the mind.
Uh-huh.
The feeling of an eye is the mind. The eye, he says, is not the same. The feeling is in the mind. No problem with that. The feeling that believes in the eye, that's feeling, that's mind, that's okay. But it's believing in an eye, so we're talking about where that eye is, that ego. Ego, eye, same. So if it's not in the body, not in the mind, where else is there? In the cracks between, maybe. Going to search for it. Are we communicating? Joan.
I'm kind of lost between the ego and the eye. Or
ego, eye, same word. We use the word ego in a very broad way in the West to refer to, I think when you're feeling angry or upset, oh, that's my ego, you know. It's really what the word I is, the same word. It's the same word. It's okay. The boss. You know, do you understand? We could say it like that. Mm-hmm. Any other suggestions? Do you think? I mean, this is what they say, you know. If the $5 is in the lounge room, if you know your $5 is in the lounge room, you just have to search really well, don't you? And you have to exhaust the search, don't you? Are you seeing what I'm saying here? You have to totally exhaust that search. And you've got two options at the end of the search, haven't you? What will be the options? You find the $5 or you find the emptiness of $5. That's right. This is what they say with this particular four-point analysis. You've first got to know what $5 looks like, and that is the hardest part. That's the first one. We've got to establish a very clear sense of what we think the inherent I would be if it did exist. And they say once you've identified that, it's easy peasy to realize emptiness. This is the hardest one, the first one. The rest is easy. Simple. And that's our hardest part. It's like we don't know what an uha is, and that's why it is difficult. That, you see, we think it's difficult to realize emptiness. It's not difficult to realize emptiness. It's difficult to pinpoint what we think the I is in the first place that doesn't exist. That's what's difficult. We don't know what it is. We can't work out what we think it is. We get confused. You see my point? The emptiness is secondary. Emptiness will come once you know what you think the I is. It's easy, easy, easy. Are you seeing what I'm saying? So you've got to work out what $5 is. Once you work out what $5 is, it's easier to find the absence of $5 in your house. Once you've worked out what you think the I is, it's easier to negate it. And that's the problem, because we don't even know what we're talking about, because we don't use these words in our daily life, you know. Are we communicating? So there's lots of other stuff that leads to this. Just notice your attachment. Notice how it exaggerates. Notice your anger. Notice how it exaggerates. These are the voices of the I. Once we've got those clear, we can get more precise, you know? Do you understand? Yeah.
I have a quick question.
Where are you, darling? Yes.
I have an 8-year-old daughter who I... trying to teach her about the philosophy of Buddhism, I guess.
Yep.
And she's definitely at the age, at 8, where something like this, we're talking about the concept of I, is very yes. strong.
Yes, absolutely.
So I was wondering if there was a way I could teach this to her, what you've been talking about with the I and the ego and the separation. Is there a way that I can teach that to... or introduce that to my 8-year-old daughter?
Well, you know, it's very interesting. You see, the... Okay. As Lama Yeshe says, the king of logics to prove this emptiness is the understanding of dependent arising, which is interdependence. And as His Holiness says, you know, a really sweet way to apply all this stuff in daily life is to simply learn to see something from another point of view. If you think of a person who's really fundamentalist, a really fundamentalist racist, or a, you know, or whatever you call, a person who's they're really narrow-minded, aren't they? They're very rigid in their thinking. They can't see past their own nose. They're absolutely fixed in their views of righteousness. Wouldn't you agree with that? That's the function of ego grasping. The more vivid this ignorance is, the more rigid we are in our mind. And literally, we're like as thick as posts. We're really stupid and ignorant. That means you can't see something from another perspective. In other words, if I've got very strong ego grasping and I've got very strong anger, I would never say, what's your name?
Oh, Chantel.
Chantel. I would never say, well, you know, I get really angry with that Chantel, and I do know it's just my projection, because I'm sure she's not really the way I think she is. No, I'm not going to say that. I'm just going to say Chantel is horrible, and I'm going to believe my view is true, aren't I? That's fundamentalism. That's the way all these delusions work, and they're rooted in the strong, strong ignorance. So when there's a stubbornness in us, which is what we are, we freak out, you can't get what I want. It's too subtle to talk about emptiness, so talk about dependent arising. And so, well, sweetheart, see it from another point of view. That is applying dependent arising, which leads us to loosen the grip of the I. You see, that's why it's too abstract. As His Holiness even says, it's sometimes easier to think about dependent arising rather than think about emptiness, you know? And dependent arising is the one that leads you to the conclusion that there is no I from its own side. So he says, just see it from another point of view. When you know people like that, they've got a very we can see their mind's very flexible, which means not much ego grasping. Ego grasping is very fixed, rigid. I'm right, you're wrong. That's how it functions. So see it from another point of view. And that means you can be tricky in the way you present things, you know. Do you understand?
Yes, thank you.
Emptiness is too difficult. Look for the eye. You know, maybe it's interesting, maybe not. We'll get very caught up and very confused. But dependent arising is the thinking to do that leads you to the conclusion that there's no eye for its own side. We don't see that immediately, but these are utterly together. They imply the same thing. There being no independent eye is the same as there being interdependence. Do you understand? Mm-hmm. We didn't talk much about interdependence here tonight, but we can do more. We will do more, I'm sure. You see what I'm saying?
Yes, I do. Thank you.
Okay, good job. Well, it's 9:15. Hang your britches on the line. Time to go home. I think, isn't it? Doris? Donna?
Yes, it's
good. Well, okay, we've been here for 1 hour and 3/4, which means as many moments as there have been is as many seeds we have, as many thoughts we've had, and as many seeds we've planted in our mind, even though we don't remember 99% of it. It doesn't matter. It's all gone in. And then we get clairvoyance as we get more advanced. We'll remember it all. So anyway, we delight. We've been listening, thinking, analysing, and you know, I'm talking, I'm doing just the same in all these ideas, and may any insights that's come, how fantastic. And may we keep nourishing these marvellous seeds so that we never give up. We're developing our potential, so we never give up helping others as well, no matter how long it takes, okay? Do you do special prayers? Do you do special dedication prayers?
For discovering Buddhism?
Gawadi and Jangchub Semchog. I'll sing them then. Yeah, may I?
Yeah.
Shall I? Okay. Gawadi nyu dudag lama sangge drub yune drawa chikyan malupa Dei sala kupashog Jangchob semchog rinpoche Makhe panam kegyuchig Khepa nyampa mepayang Gongne gongdu pevashog. Thank you, everybody. Thank you very much.
All right, it's okay. I'm going to see you back there.
Yes.
See you somewhere.
Yes. Great.
Okay, thanks, everybody.
Bye. Thank you.
Are you talking for home?
No.
Yes.
Yes.